میدونیم تو چه کشوری داریم خدمت میکنیم.
So first thing is in Iran we know what country we're serving the Islamic Republic of Iran.
میدونیم اگه ما رو بگیرن به اون تجاوز میشه، کتک میخوریم، حتی میکشن.
We know that if they get us, the first thing they will do to us as a woman is rape us, and then they'll beat us, and then ultimately they'll kill us.
و یه تصمیمه که جون تو بدی.
And this is the decision that we have made that we want to offer our bodies as sacrifices.
برای اینکه امروز من از خونه میرم بیرون نمیدونم برمیگردم.
Because I have this thought when I wake up, when I leave that door, I might not come back.
و من با همسرم حرف زدم و هر دوتامون اینو برای همدیگه حل کردیم.
And I've talked to my husband and we made an agreement that this is the decision of our lives, so if we leave that door and we don't come back, we accept the consequences of what happened.
Rejecting a deal that prevents Iran from getting a nuclear weapon and instead leaves Iran the option of installing more and more advanced centrifuges, shrinking their breakout time, that somehow is going to make our neighbors more secure, I think is kind of, it doesn't make any sense. I think what
Israel and Iran are staring each other down tonight across the expanse of Syria. Long simmering hostility flared to life last night as the Israelis blasted Iranian fighters in Syria with their largest airstrike since the 1973 war.
I think Iran is a threat. I think it's a very big threat. And I think I did a great thing when I terminated the ridiculous Iran nuclear deal.
I've seen that you called the Ayatollah Khamenei, the new Hitler of the Middle East.
The Lebanese Shia paramilitary group has evolved from a ragtag militia to a military and political heavyweight. It's part of the so-called Axis of Resistance against Israel, referring to the alliance between Hezbollah, Hamas, Syria, and Iran.
So there's still many questions about
Israel has retaliated for an attack on its troops by targeting what it says was Iran's military infrastructure inside Syria. Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu said the airstrikes were appropriate.
In his words, Iran crossed a red line with Wednesday's missile attack on Israeli forces in the Golan Heights. Israel warns that any further aggression will be met with overwhelming force.
Right now we're in the Golan Heights, right where the borders of Syria, Lebanon, and Israel meet. And the border of Jordan is within eyesight. This explosive and controversial plateau, I think, puts the issue of Iran in its contemporary geopolitical context into proper perspective in our generation. Because for the last number of years, Iran has been pumping money and strategic weapons and fighters and infrastructure from the Himalayas all the way to the Mediterranean across the expanse of the Middle East. While they've been fueling this massive movement of spreading Shia Islam all across the region, another movement has been growing up under their noses within Iran's borders itself.
I believe what is happening in the Church of Iran is going to become a measuring stick for the global body of Christ. It's not something that we can from afar look on and admire. It's going to be something that's required of us to participate in. It's going to disrupt our lives. It's an invitation from Jesus to say yes to more, because where we're headed, it's going to require more. What we have now is not enough. What we need is something that Iran right now is touching. And it's our responsibility as the global body of Christ to say yes to this invitation.
In the book of Revelation chapter 12, we get a picture, a description of what the end time church looks like. She's bruised and bloodied, but she's also triumphant and victorious. It says this, the church at the end overcomes by the blood of the Lamb, the word of their testimony, and by not loving their lives unto death. Today, the church in Iran is already walking in that. And I believe that the Lord is going to take this issue of the testimony, the story, the witness of the church in Iran, and thrust it into the heart of the global body of Christ, that we would follow in their footsteps and learn from them. I believe the Lord is putting their message on blast for us in this hour to prepare us for the days ahead.
So this week we're here in Indonesia meeting with a group of leaders from the underground church in Iran. Because of security inside the country, they actually have to come outside of the country for more intensive training, gathering, equipping, refreshing, and fellowship.
Joel and I have been joining them for these gatherings for the last 5 years or so. I can say with certainty that no other person or group of people have impacted me more than the Iranians have. It's been a holy privilege to journey with them, and it's been such an honor to know them and to get to know them deeper.
We've met with the Iranian leaders in countries all over the world. This year, it's quite fitting that we're doing it here. Indonesia is the largest Muslim country in the world.
We can't take people inside of Iran to meet them, but we can take their stories out of Iran for people to hear them. I think it's significant and profoundly meaningful that we're learning and hearing about the fastest growing church in the world today here in the largest Muslim nation in the world today.
For people outside of Iran, is it true?
To Iran?
Mm-hmm.
They don't. I'm sitting in my balcony right now. It's 3:00 in the morning. In front of the lights of Tehran, just looking at the city lights, the skyline, figuring out what's going to happen in the next few days.
When I ask most Westerners and I say, you know, what do you picture when you think Iranians? And the vast majority of people, you know, they say, you know, Ahmadinejad, the mullahs, the ayatollahs. They go, you know, I see all of these angry Muslims shaking their fists, chanting death to America, death to Israel, and this sort of thing. And the reality is that in the country, it's nothing like that.
Today, Iran is home to the fastest growing church in the world. It's almost entirely Muslim background. They have no denominational leanings or affiliation. They have no governmental recognition or legitimacy. They have no bank accounts. They have no 501c3s. They have no centralized leadership. They have no Bible schools or seminaries. They own no properties or church buildings, and they possess no assets. On top of that, while being Muslim background, they are, by and large, aggressively and passionately pro-Israel. That is, they love the Jewish people. And on top of that, it's predominantly led by women.
What if I told you that Islam is dead? What if I told you that the mosques are empty inside of Iran? Iran that is known as the most radical nation in the world, exporting terrorism, exporting radical Islam, but when you go inside of the country, the mosques are empty. What if I told you that no one follows Islam inside of Iran? Would you believe me? But this is exactly what's happening inside of Iran. God is moving powerfully inside of Iran.
The ruling class are the religious class, and many of them are religious because that's where the high-paying jobs are. But the majority of the people are just normal, ordinary people. They love God, but they recognize that Islam is the problem.
What if I told you that an evangelist for Jesus came inside of Iran? What if I told you that the best evangelist for Jesus was Imam Khomeini, the Ayatollahs? You might be wondering, what do you mean? How is that possible? Because the Ayatollahs and Imam Khomeini brought the true face of Islam. And when people in Iran saw the true face of Islam, they found out that it was a lie, that it was evil, and that it was deception. Because after 40 years under Islamic law, a utopia, according to them, they've had the worst devastation known in the history, in the 5,000 year history of Iran.
مسیح با این فرمان تو متا گفت که برین و متا رو شاگرد بسازید و این باعث افتخار منه که دارم توی حکم مسیح رو میرم.
You know, the form of church planting in Iran is a very interesting topic because in Iran for many years and we've seen persecution, and what persecution did was destroy the church that weren't disciples and destroyed the church that were about converts. The seismic shift that's happened in the Church of Iran is when all these church planters found out that converts run away from persecution, but disciples will die for the Lord of persecution. So the church planting method inside of Iran is we don't convert to disciple, we disciple to convert. So we take them on a journey from the beginning, where God started, to Christ, where God fully reveals himself.
توی ایران ما دیممو اینطوری شروع میکنیم، کلیسا رو اینطوری میخواییم آغاز بکنیم، شروع بکنیم که اول از همه
من عاشق دیمم به خاطر اینکه دست شیطان رو بسته، به خاطر اینکه خیلی مرموزانه و پشت پرده مردم به سمت نجات میاره، همونجا که مسیح تو کلامش میگه که مثل مار هوشیا و من مثل کبوتر بیازار باش.
If you look in the life of Christ, he started discipling people immediately, just as the Lord discipled people from the first interaction in the DMM process. We disciple people from the first interaction around God. So from the first interaction, they learn how to thank God, they learn how to pray to God, they learn how to minister to each other, they learn how to read the word and know about the authority of the word, they get messages in their vertical relationship with God, they get horizontal messages in their relationship with people, and they learn to evangelize all before they come to Christ.
I think we use the term discipleship in a wonky and somewhat of a misguided way in the West. Meaning, when we say discipleship, typically what we mean in the Western context is I'm mentoring a believer to grow in Christ-likeness and maturity. But that's not necessarily what discipleship is. That's part of it for sure, but the thing is, discipleship starts day one. Meaning, when you meet an unbeliever who's never heard the name of Jesus before, and you start teaching him to obey the commands of Jesus, whether he knows Jesus' name or not, you are entering into discipleship with him right there in that moment.
This is the pillars of DMM because, and the word discipleship is discipline. So we're disciplining them or showing them how they must interact with God the same way Christ disciplined and corrected the disciples when they weren't interacting with God correctly.
And this is why the gospel is spreading like a wildfire in Iran, is because they believe discipleship starts the first second you come in contact with somebody. A disciple maker is someone who stewards the commands of Jesus and presses the teachings of Jesus as the central issue in every situation. This is why I think the church in Iran is so valuable for the church globally right now at this historical juncture.
One of the things that hits my heart about the church in Iran is the way in which I think the Lord is using the Iranian church to speak to the church in the West. Yeah, we're here in an old bombed out Syrian officer's quarters that's been repurposed as a cattle pasture, and you can see them all around us, and maybe you'll hear them. And as we kind of sit here, it's I don't know, it kind of hits me as being ironic. It reminds me of the proverb, Proverbs 14:4, where it says, where there are no oxen, or there are no cattle, you know, the stable is clean, but with the oxen come the increase. You need a oxen to get the work done, to create to have a harvest. But if you're going to have the oxen, then it's going to be messy. To see the harvest, to really truly see the harvest come, it's not going to be clean. It's not going to be tidy. There's going to be a mess. Oftentimes, it just doesn't come in the form that we think it'll come.
So I remember a few years ago when Dalton and I were going to meet all of the underground Iranian leaders for the first time. And beforehand, we had this sort of idea in our mind, you know, these guys are the special forces, they're the cutting edge, they're leading the fastest growing church network in the world and one of the most difficult, restricted nations in the earth under intense persecution. And then we met them.
This is the glory of the Iranian church, the power of God being displayed among the broken, the dejected, and the depraved. It's here in the brutality and the mess of human dysfunction that we see his wonder. Jesus can use anyone, any place, at any time, and he is not afraid of the mess.
They were just the most beautiful, glowing, even if I could say it, goofballs, you know? They're just fun, beautiful people. We instantly fell in love with them. What he's doing, these amazing things, is he's using regular, everyday people, just like you and me. And this is where Dalton looked at me and he said, it's just like sheep among wolves. And he said, that's the name of the film. It's going to be Sheep Among Wolves.
وقتی ما بیریم برای بشارت دادن میبینیم که مسیح قبل از ما اونجا رفته توی خوابشون یا توی یک معجزه و وقتی ما میشنویم میفهمیم That's why in DML we have the ultimate rule is see one, do one, teach one. That's what they learn. I was like, so even their unbelievers, how do they become leader? They're watching, oh, you want
want to see how to do it, come with me on the street. Even their unbeliever, watch how I talk.
شروع میکنیم به این که دعا میکنیم و با دعا حرکت میکنیم، افراد رو با دعا انتخاب میکنیم. وقتی که دعا کردیم و رفتیم با اون شخص صحبت کردیم و باهاش شروع میکنیم و اینجا اون شخص خودش میتونه بره به هر کسی بگه که اول از همه از خانوادهش شروع میشه و از هر کدوم از اعضای خانوادش که شروع بکنه، وقتی که دو نفر بشن خودشون یه کلیسا میشن از همون هفته اول. یعنی ما میتونیم در عرض یک هفته توی زمانی که میذاریم برای دی ام و معرفی کردن داستانه و داستان یک رو خوندن یه کلیسا داشته باشیم و مهم نیستش که این کلیسا تعدادش زیاد باشه یا کم باشه و لازم نیست که شعبان داشته باشه، معلم داشته باشه یا هر چیز دیگه. کلیسایی که تشکیل میشه تو همون جلسه اول، کلیسایی که همه کارش و کنترل کنندش خداست، برای اینکه خدا همه چی رو توی دست داره و اونا خودشون نمیدونن که چه اتفاقی داره میفته، ولی خدا داره یه مرحله شاگردسازی رو باهاشون شروع میکنه از همون اول.
At the 12, if we look at the tenet of Christianity, which is Jesus is the Son of God, that he died on the cross, and he was resurrected 3 days later, were the disciples technically believers? They were not. And if we look in Matthew and in Luke with Jesus sending out the 70, those 70 were not believers. And here they are, exercising demons, healing people, and proclaiming the kingdom.
When we talk about church planting in the West, well, generally what we're talking about is a pastor or a teacher starting a community that's built around the pastor and the teacher who listen to him give speeches for half an hour or to an hour once a week. And this is foreign to the Iranians. This is foreign to the Afghan church because the expression of church planting in the Muslim world today is not planting churches, it's making disciples.
If we look at Jesus' model, technically, he's letting unbeliever lead other unbelievers to himself or the kingdom of God.
Jesus didn't command us to plant churches. He commanded us to make disciples. You can try to plant a church and you might make disciples. But if you make disciples, you will plant churches.
If your method is really from God, it should work anytime, anywhere, with anyone. It doesn't matter that you're an illiterate Afghan girl or you're a doctor, you know, in the capital of Tehran. It should be as engaging to that doctor and as simple to that Afghan girl. So the implications of DMM is we could actually finish the Great Commission in our generation.
He's the Word of God in color, the Father revealed to us. The only way, the highest name, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
In 2014, ISIS blitzkrieged this entire region and established the capital of their caliphate just a few kilometers to the west of here, just down there in Mosul.
During that initial push to the east, ISIS was halted at the bottom of this mountain by the Peshmerga, that's the Kurdish military forces. The Kurds dug in and protected this monastery and everything east of here between here and the Iranian border. Then in October 2016, the Peshmerga began a campaign in which they effectively drove ISIS out of the Nineveh Plains and liberated the entire area around Mosul. We were here throughout that entire period providing emergency medical care during the fighting. As that campaign was raging and ISIS was losing ground, something very, very important happened. The Iraqi Ministry of Defense made the decision to actually federalize Iranian-backed Shia militias, incorporating them into the Iraqi army. The Iraqi security forces today are now over 90% Shia. The majority of them are actually former members of this Iranian-backed militia. In 2017, those militias drove the Peshmerga out of the Nineveh Plains and took complete control of it. Sadly, they actually used American tanks and weapons to do so. As the international community sat idle and covered their eyes, Iranian forces overran the Kurds who stopped ISIS. Iran has established an even more formidable foothold throughout the region. It was a tragedy. It was a travesty of epic proportions. This is just one example of what is happening all over the Middle East. Iran is sponsoring armed militias to fight the Sunnis and anyone else who gets in their way. As a result, they now essentially control five capitals. They control Tehran, they control Baghdad in Iraq, they control Damascus in Syria, they control Beirut in Lebanon, they control Sana'a in Yemen. They are heavily influencing the region, primarily through a growing proxy war from the Himalayas all the way to the Mediterranean.
When you're here in Indonesia, there's a painful reality that just very quickly slaps you in the face. This, in so many ways, it is the ends of the earth. Yet this is the largest, most populous Muslim nation in the world. Indonesia is tremendously far removed from Arabia, and yet Islam, the great counterfeit, has been wildly successful in thoroughly evangelizing this nation.
The central issue that we're actually talking about is this issue of obedience. We're not talking about evangelism or missions or church planting. What we're actually talking about is this issue of obedience to the king. And I think the enemy understands the power of obedience, which is why this great counterfeit of Islam was predicated, was built upon the foundation of complete surrender and obedience. And this is the heart of jihad, is to give everything that you have, is to give all of your body, all of your blood, all of your energy, all of your everything, all of your all for your Lord, to whom you are a slave. And the enemy has taken this issue of being a bond slave, which is lodged in the heart of the gospel, has taken that and built this entire demonic religion around obedience to a false god and a false religion.
And it's really a glaring just example of where we as the church in many ways have failed to take the gospel to the ends of the earth, whereas the counterfeit has been wildly successful.
You know, we have a couple options here. We can either hate the counterfeit and we can respond out of a place of anger and yet still be disobedient to our king. Thus, we bring him no glory and we move the ball no further down the field, so to speak. Or we can love those who have been seduced by the counterfeit, and we ourselves can give of ourselves unreservedly to our Lord, who is the only way, the truth, and the life. I believe that this is the issue that we need to recover in these days before the return of the Lord. And this is how the gospel of the kingdom will spread across cultures and nations and languages and people groups, is because of obedience to the one who is worthy of the adoration and the worship and the obedience of the nations.
proving is very powerful in DMM is that it is an obedience-based discipleship, where the ultimate authority is the scriptures. And every time you read the scriptures, you must obey it. This is how people become conformed to the image of Christ and sanctified. They're just not reading the Bible for information. They're reading the Bible to get transformed. And their expectation of when they read the Bible is transformation. And if it doesn't happen, they don't continue. If you do not obey what you were given that week and you do not share, we do not go forward. The end result of DMM is this, is that one, you have the ability to stand alone. Two, it's highly reproducible. And three, you're highly obedient to Christ.
Now think about it. If a false gospel could spread this rapidly and multiply this aggressively, then the gospel can too, but with greater force. Because the gospel far eclipses Islam's ability to replicate itself in the hearts of its followers and believers because it's true.
I have a story of a girl that was raped since she can remember. As she reads Genesis chapter 3, which is about the fall and forgiveness of the Father, and she says, if God can forgive Adam and Eve after he's given them everything and just loved on them, then I can forgive my father that's raped me all my life.
You're not done with us. Moving as we sing.
We let the Holy Spirit lead and trust him that he will teach and preach and touch people in such a magnificent way that when you hear the stories, you just want to cry. If you're not crying in your church because of the radical things the Holy Spirit is doing, then there's a problem. Because people were so radicalized by what the Holy Spirit were doing in the book, in the book of Acts in the New Testament, they gave up everything. That's what's missing in the West. The power of the Holy Spirit comes so deeply, intimately, and transformably.
The simple thing that strikes me as a difference between the church in Iran and the church in the West, the church where I serve, is that we seem to believe that people can sit in a seat in a congregation for a really, really long time, and maybe at some point in their life, they'll begin to follow the Lord in a striking and a significant enough way that they might actually be and make disciples. It could happen. It's possible. And when I compare that to the church in Iran, it seems as though in Iran, a person comes to know the Lord and immediately they're activated into being and becoming and making disciples. It's a striking difference. If you want to know one of the key ways I think that we need to flip the script and learn from the church in Iran, it's the timing. Or the time between coming to know Jesus as Lord and Savior and actually becoming a disciple maker.
از خدا میپرسم که کدوم قسمت شهادتم به این شخص میتونه کمک کنه. وقتی که روح القدس نشون میده تو قلبم باز میکنه اون موضوع رو، شهادت میدم رو اون قسمت، دنبال عکس العمل روح القدسم. یه جا در مورد تجاوز میگم، یه جا در مورد حتی کتک خوردن، بی‌محبتی و یه جا خودکشی.
We're sitting in the room with all the leaders, and I was sitting in the back and just looking at everyone, and one of the leaders leaned over to me and he said, you know, the thing that's so amazing about all the people in this room is that just several years ago, despite all that they're doing now, everyone in this room was either a radical Muslim, they were addicted to drugs, suicidal, or even in prostitution. And when he said that, I just choked up. I mean, just the thought of it just gripped me. But then I actually heard their personal stories. I heard their testimonies, and it absolutely broke me. I love these people so much.
hearing how unique and personal every one of their stories are is mind-blowing. There's these common denominators across the board with all of them. You know, dreams, visions, miracles, healing, signs and wonders. There's these common denominators. But the thing that's unique is that in every single one of their lives is this story of personal intervention where the Lord interrupted their lives in a personal way that is deeply connected to their own trauma, their own rape, their own addictions, their own internal struggles, their own family trauma. It's some of the stuff is brutal and horrific, but this is where Jesus displays his glory, I think, in the most beautiful ways, is amidst human brokenness. And the thing that blows me away is every single story is so personal, so unique, so standalone. And I think this testifies to the glory of God, that he's deeply personal, and he's after each human being, and he's after each individual heart. And this, to me, is one of the most powerful elements of this whole story of the Iranian awakening.
The story's so powerful because she had the marking of the rope. So I don't know how we can. So maybe we can talk about it.
تو سن 19 سالگی بودم و تو اوج افسردگی زیر نظر یکی از بهترین پزشکای کشور بودم و هیچ چیز بهم جواب نداد. چهار سال توی اتاق تنها زندگی کردم و تو همین اوضاع فقط برای گرفتن سیگار یا چیزایی که نیاز داشتم فقط بیرون میرفتم. یه روز که بیرون رفته بودم با یه شخص آشنا شدم. من اصلا نمیشناختمش. با همدیگه آشنا شدیم. بعد یه مقدار گفت چرا سوال برای شد که چرا اینجوری شدم. یه مقدار از زندگی واسش تعریف کردم. و یه نیشخند زد. گفت همش همین. گفتم که چطور من گفت زندگی من خیلی بدتر از این بود. گفتم خب چی شد که الان اینجوری؟ گفت دوست داری بدونی؟ گفتم بله. گفت فردا بیا مغازم. و فردا رفت فرداش رفتم مغازش و شروع کرد بشارت مسیحو دادن و بهم گفتش که هر چیز بخوای تو این هست. کلام بهم داد. رفتم خونه. تو اوج چالش بودم. خونه ما خیلی قدیمی بود. سنگای کف شل شده بودن. هر وقت که راه میرفتی صداشون میومد. به معنی که گفتم اگه هستی خودتو ثابت کن، جلوی خودم صدای 4 تا از اون سنگا رو شنیدم که یک نفر راه رفت و فضای اتاق به حدی پر شد از یه چیزی که نمیدونستم، ولی من نمیتونم تکون بخورم. و اینجا شد و من بلا فاصله رفتم پیش همون دوستم. گفت خویخ خیلی عادیه. از خود و از این خود خیلی بیشتر باید ببینیم و کاملا دیگه مسیح رو بسن باز کن و گفت دوست داری به این خدا ایمان بیاری و من گفتم خیلی مشتاق و قلبم مسیح.
Things that I think surprises a lot of people when they first meet a lot of the leaders in the underground church is that the majority of them are actually women.
It's just overwhelming when you see the number of women, young women, oftentimes even teenage women who are at the heads of significant disciple-making movements. Women who are willing to lay their lives down, women who look their husbands in the eyes and say, this message, this fire that I carry in my bones is so significant that if it cost me my life, if it cost me my body, I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid.
Two
زنان نقش اساسی رو دارن توی دین من و چیزی که الان جا افتاده اینه که زن و مرد و بچه نداره، هر کسی میتونه دین رو ببره جلو و واقعا یکی از مشکلات بود توی کلیسای قدیم که زنان رو قبول نداشتن تو خیلی از شهر، میری فقط دوستشونی، مشکلشون رو میبینی، دعا میکنی، از خدا میگیری که چی بگی و مردم ایران این شخصیت رو دوست دارن که عاشق این هستن که سر در بیارن از زندگی خصوصی و اینجوری خیلی راحت میتونی تجربت رو بگی، شهادت زندگی تو بگی و عوض شدن تو بگی که خدا چی کار کرد. این داستان ها اومد تو زندگی و خدای این داستان ها زندگی ما عوض کرد، رابطه رو برقرار میکنی و اینطوری میشه که وارد میشی. بعد از یه مدتی خیلی راحت میتونی بری توی زندگیشون و اینجاست که میتونی دوست خیلی خوبی باشی براشون. There's a beauty in our pain. Every night is a breaking day. We are calling jars of clay. So carry on. Carry on.
Think about the difference between the God of the Bible and the God of the Quran. The God of Islam, he's not personal. He's great, he's big, he's almighty, but he's distant. He's not the God who gives you a hug, so to speak. So when you hear these stories, what they emanate is how personal this God was who was encountering them, so much so that not only does it break you because you hear their stories, but it breaks you because you see in their stories, you see even Jesus's heart for you.
You know, one of the significant truths that the realities that exist in Iran is that when you're caught, you know, carrying this Christian message, that you not only lose your life, but you can be raped. And for a woman to say that this message is so important, this message is so significant, that I'm willing to look at my life in light of eternity and recognize that Jesus has bought me at a great price. My body's not my own. And if the cost that I have to pay, the price that I have to pay to see the gospel go forth in my nation is the laying down of my body.
من توی خانواده نظامی بزرگ شدم که پدر مادرم تو ارتش شاه بودن. بابام وقتی از ارتش اومد بیرون تصمیم گرفت که یه کاری دست و پا کنه و با یه نفر شریک شد و دوستش رو وارد خونه‌مون کرد، ولی دوستش به من دست زد توی بچگی و این کار رو هی ادامه داد و من میترسیدم به بابام بگم و مامانم متوجه شد و به بابام گفت. بابام شروع کرد منو زد، ولی دوستش از خونه بیرون نکرد و ادامه داد اون شراکتش رو با دوستش. من از مرد، از اون صورت، از اون حالت بدم می اومد دیگه. از اونجا رابطه من با بابام قطع شد، رابطه احساسی، برای اینکه ازش بدم اومد دیگه و احساس کردم شمایتی از طرفش نداشتم. من یاد گرفته بودم از مامانم که خدایی وجود نداره. حتی تو سن 13 سالگی میتونستم به یه کسی که معلم دینی بود ثابت کنم که خدا نیست. از اونجا دوباره افسردگی من روشن شد. ولی من در کنارش به خاطر افسردگی روز 12 تا قرص میخورم. 2 سال نمیتونستم بخندم، نمیتونستم گریه کنم، هیچ عکس العمل نداشت. 5 بار اقدام خودکشی کردم با قرص. سقف خونه های ما چون سمت جنوب بود به جای پنکه حلقه داشت. من یه روز تصمیم گرفتم که خودم رو دار بزنم. قرصامو خوردم هیچ نفهم. فقط به خدا اینو گفتم اگه هستی میخوام به دست بزنم. تا این کارو کردم، رفتم بالا خودمو پرت کردم. هیچی نمیفهمیدم، همه چیز سیاه. من 4 ثانیه مسیح ملاقات کردم. من دیدم رو دوش مسیح هم مثل یه بچه که به پدرش آویزون میشه. همیشه آرزو داشتم این کار رو با من.
Wipe the tears away from your eyes and drive the fear away from your mind. You have no idea how safe you really are. Believe me when I say it's true, I am coming back for you. Baby, if you only knew how soon, how soon.
بهش گفتم منو رو زمین نذار، من میترسم. فقط بهم گفتش که من ازت محافظت میکنم، من ازت محافظت میکنم، حتی نمیذارم پاد به یه سنگ بخوره. مزامیر 91 رو بهم وقتی که این تموم شد، همش 4 ثانیه بود، من چشمامو باز کردم و تختم از خواب بلند شد. بلند شدم روی زمین رو نگاه کردم، دیدم اون تناب دور گردن من باز شده، دور گردنم سیاه بود. بعد ها گریه کردم، بعد از 2 سال احساس میکردم دارم شفا میگیرم. اونجا برای من تموم شد همه این چیز، برای من مسیح رو شناختم. بعد از اون قرصام رو گذاشتم کنار، دیگه میتونستم راحت بخوابم. Trust the Father and trust in me and on his land we'll build our mansion that where که بدرم فوت کرد، من اون شخص رو بالای قبر بابام دیدم. تو جمعیت دنبال من میگشت، من قایم کردم خودم رو برای اینکه ترسیدم و اونجا روح القدس با قلبم حرف زد، گفت نه ترس، منو بردمش که تو به یاد بیاری و این شخص رو ببخش. اونجا احساس کردم اون شفا قلبم. جواب سوالشو بده.
This week we were on the Iraq-Iran border, cross-training Iranian and international leaders to learn from each other and to encourage one another. A big part of what we're looking at is this issue of structure and methodology associated with decentralized leadership. Also the powerful role of women in disciple-making movements.
So I love so many of these church planting movements that are rising up. I mean, they're doing amazing things, planting churches in cities all across the West that we would never expect. But when it comes to places like Syria, Tehran, Iran, Afghanistan, these traditional ecclesiological models, they don't often work. And we need to be creative. We need to be flexible. The gospel doesn't change. The message doesn't change. The goal doesn't change. But if we can make followers of Jesus, if we can make disciples, we'll use any method and any model necessary.
We need to return to the ancient paths and to recover apostolic leadership literacies.
Iran is one of the only countries in the Middle East that's actually led by women. The percentage of women is 55 to 45 in leadership and in believers. And I think God is saying something.
There's a feminist movement in the West right now. A lot of it is revolving around sexual abuse. It's a good thing that it's being exposed and coming into the light. A lot of it's also revolved around women's rights, equal pay, these types of things. I've lived in an area on the earth where women's rights It's not even a real thing. What's fascinating about what's happening in Iran right now is that the most powerful leaders are women. But it's not in a bombastic, humanistic way of, I am just as good, I am just as strong. In fact, they are the most gentle women. I see, in contrast to what's emerging in the West, there's so much humanism that true freedom and liberation can't come. There's offense and bitterness that's really firing and fueling this movement in the West. Whereas here, it's grace, forgiveness, mercy, and thankfulness.
Things that is in the, that's problematic in the West is that the West doesn't understand that man and woman is a complete picture of God, and it's, and you can't make one more significant or more important. It's just like which one's more important? Is Jesus more important than God, or is the Holy Spirit more important than God? When you look at the triune, it's a complete picture of God. And when you look at man and woman, it's a complete picture of God. And this is something that's happening in Iran, is that women are rising up, apostolic women, prophetic women, teaching women.
The believing women in Iran are actually the some of the most powerful leaders probably in the world. Because of this, the circumstances, again, in which they live, they have to go deep in their faith. They have to be bold. They have to be strong. They not in strength on their own, but they have to lean into the strength of God. You know, God says, I have enough strength. It's your weakness I need. And I believe that they've given him their weakness and they are leaning into his strength. They are leading this movement inside of the country. They are going out on the in the highways and byways and sharing Jesus with prostitutes, with drug addicts, with everybody they come in contact with. And that honestly takes courage. And so they are courageous women.
توی ایران برای این هستش که زن میتونه آزادی بیان بیشتری داشته باشه. خیلی وقتا دیگه اینجوری نیستش که یه زن بخواد اجازه بگیره برای انجام دادن کاری. برای اینکه خیلی درد کشیدن و خیلی سختی دیدن و این درد و سختی قویشون کرده.
You know, I come from the West and I come from where life is easy. We live for our own pleasure, we live for our own comfort, we live for our own safety. Basically, we live for ourselves. And these ladies live for Jesus. You know, meeting these ladies changed me.
And when I see all of these young and old women who are leading one of the most powerful resistance movements in the earth, it's a godly resistance movement against the oppression of Satan.
They're my heroes.
واقعا بیشتر زنای ایران مشکلات خیلی زیادی دارن، از فقر گرفته تا تجاوز، کتک زدن، و اینا قویشون کرده. برای همین حرکت میکنن، مخصوصا زنایی که معتاد هستن، اینا خیلی بیشتر سخت کشید و این باعث میشه که خودشون یه رهبر بشن.
The area of the earth where women are feeling the most oppression, you get the most authority, you get the most influence, you get the most fruit.
And even when we have verses like 2 Timothy, women are still in submission to their husband, just like Jesus was still submitted to the Father, but he still was God. He still moved. He still was able to minister. We didn't say, well, you know what? Because you're somewhat second in command, you cannot. And the same is happening inside of Iran.
On one hand, they understand the order of the church. You know, they're in a very biblical way, they're submissive to proper structure and order. But when it comes to what Satan's doing, they are fierce. They are fierce. You know, these are not like modern, you know, just angry liberal women that are just upset about, no, there's a gentleness and a submissiveness that's beautiful, and it follows the biblical pattern. But when it comes to what Satan's doing, no way, they won't have any of it.
چون مهم نیست که رهبر توی DMM آدم خوبی باشه یا بد. یه آدم پوش، یه مواد فروش، حتی زن، و ما از این زن ها کم نداریم توی ایران. و این باعث میشه که بتونیم خیلی جلو حرکت بکنیم نسبت به کشورهای دیگه. حالا میدونم که هر چیزی دلیلی داره. اگه زنای ایرانی تو این درد بودن، دلیلش این بود که بتونن الان رهبر باشن و DMM رو ببرن جلو توی ایران. آمین.
I'm a PK or a pastor's kid. I've been in and around the church my whole life. I have a lot of affection for the body of Christ all around the world. So many awesome experiences and great leadership. But if I'm honest, I do see some coming shifts in the way that we as leaders begin to operate, particularly in the body of Christ. One of the things that I've learned from the leaders in the church in Iran, when they see a 19-year-old or a 20-year-old, 21-year-old begin to come to faith, begin to get passionate about the ministry of the gospel, when they see that person, they're visualizing that in a year's time, that person could be leading a church. That's revolutionary in the way we think. Traditionally, if someone's passionate about ministry, maybe they go to some years of training, they serve for 10 years in a role, and then maybe at some point, 20, 30 years down the road, they would lead an expression of gospel ministry somewhere. Where I think what's exciting is where we see the church multiplying so rapidly, we see this different kind of philosophy and perspective where instead of trying to continue to build up the center of what we're doing, they're actually beginning to see people as leaders and empower and release them to go run and build themselves. Where we're actually saying to people, God's put a passion in you, just run and go for it. And I think that's one of the keys I see where the church is multiplying rapidly is that heart and that sentiment to say, I see the work of the Lord in your life. I see the anointing on your life. Go for it.
I have a challenge for the West, and this is my challenge. What's your discipleship program for a person like Samson if they came to your church? Would you make them a leader? Samson wasn't just a leader. He's a hero of faith. But I know many churches would say, you have character issues, you have anger issues, you have lust issues. Fix that first, and then I'll put you in leadership. But DMM, we don't look at the outside. We're looking at the inside, which means we're looking at the hand of God. And in DMM, you see the hand of God on people. This is why we have people like Samson, and they're leading hundreds, even thousands of people to Christ. This is why we have prostitutes who are leading hundreds of other prostitutes to Christ, because Jesus knows what he's doing.
Where we give people that kind of permission, I think that's where we begin to see the fruit begin to be born so rapidly. But here's the other thing. We have to be willing to go through the mess that producing creates. The graveyard has perfect order, but a nursery's, there's life.
People that Jesus chose, I know for us it would be very hard to choose that because we're looking at the outside. But the thing is, we need to look at where God's hand is, and DMM is all about the Holy Spirit and who he's chosen.
So when we look at a Muslim context in terms of you know, envisioning the advance of the gospel in the Middle East, the hardware, if we can use the computer analogy, the hardware that we have right now in the West can't run the software of the gospel in the Middle East. In fact, I don't even think it can run in the US. I don't even think it can run in Europe, but we're still perpetuating this model. We're still selling the hardware, even though we haven't quite realized in the West that our software doesn't run on it. You know, and I think you come to a place like this, you know, a mosque in the midst of the Muslim world, and you start asking these questions: how could the gospel take root here? How could we see a multiplication movement start here, where we could see leaders released now at the very beginning, not 5 years into the thing?
So there's this shift where we begin to go, you know, I'm not afraid of things being a little disorderly. I'm not afraid of how people might perceive me or my ministry. I'd rather have life. I'd rather have new babies around the house. I'd rather see people learn and grow by making mistakes early so that they can lead boldly and powerfully.
Are people building churches, and there's lots of churches, and people joining churches in Iran? What does it look like?
No. ساختمون‌ها رو دائماً در حال خراب کردنن و می‌بندن دراشون رو و اگه کلیسایی هست همه‌شون زیرزمینی.
Message has always been the same. The gospel message hasn't changed. I think the methodologies over time have to, because there's always change on the earth. And so we're standing in this church today, which is now a tourist attraction, because at some point it became irrelevant. You know, and so I think we just need to evaluate how we're reaching people. And we can't fall in love with the method. We have to stay in love with Jesus. And then we have to figure out how to connect with people, because people want to, it's a connection with people, it's a relationship, it's not a system or a methodology. We just can't fall in love with methods or practices. It's about the person of Jesus coming, giving his life, and this person knowing that there's a need inside of them, and he's the one that fulfills the need. But sometimes these structures have created places that actually make it harder, even though the intent was not that in the beginning, and perhaps it was even something that was fruitful at the time. But there's seasons for everything, and so I think we continually have to evaluate how we're reaching people.
I remember having a conversation with one of the leaders in the church in Iran, and I was asking them, you know, what is the secret to the power dimension that's flowing through the body there, the signs, the wonders, the supernatural things that they're seeing, you know, on a daily basis. And his answer was not what I expected, but really insightful. And he talked about how the body, he used the living stones passage, where we're living stones being fit together, and it's those living stones that become the habitation of Jesus in the earth. And, you know, he was saying how they do, you know, they go on a retreat and there'll be 80 people sharing two bedrooms. And so all this collision happens. And the cool thing is they don't have anywhere else to go. So instead of like breaking off and starting another church, they stay together and endure the positioning of their lives, these living stones, and they're fitted into an actual spiritual and physical structure, a collection of human beings that now become the habitation of Jesus in their region.
You know, if we did a case study on all of the places that the gospel is advancing right now in the Middle East, and we do a study of the kind of leadership structures that have been implemented at the foundational ground level,
what we see is that the leadership is decentralized and it's distributed, meaning it's not based around a particular model. It's not based around a particular individual or skill set or gifting. It's built around an Ephesians 4 framework of empowering everyone in the body to be all things to all men, with the fullness of the power of the Holy Spirit being manifest through all of us. Now, when Paul was writing to the church in Ephesus, he said, guys, look, the same grace that was given to me to be an apostle is the same grace that's been given to each of you, to all of us. Which means if the same grace that was available to make Paul an apostle, if that same grace is available for the entire body of Christ, that means that the entire body of Christ should have the yoke of leadership upon them for disciple making, for the apostolic, for the prophetic, for the evangelistic, for the pastoral, and for the teaching. But if we reduce the church to pastoral and teaching ministry, and we sever the rest of it, and we just try to throw evangelism in, or throw the prophetic in, or throw the apostolic in, it's gonna undermine the church's ability to actually be the church.
The paradigm shift when it comes to structures, and even as we stand in this ancient church, is the realization that Jesus isn't looking to inhabit buildings. We've had buildings. And obviously, as we look out on the nations and as we're standing in an old structure, it hasn't worked. And so if we can begin to perceive the people as the stones, the living stones, the people as the structure that's gonna bring the habitation of Jesus in our midst, if we can believe that and buy into that, then we can commit to cultivating and developing human structures of people, discipleship-making movements, where we're bringing people together, understanding that that is actually the pathway that brings the glory and the presence of Jesus.
The software of the gospel will not run on the hardware of Western church in the Middle East. We need to have different hardware to run the software, and until that happens, we are going to be unable to see the gospel advance and take root in an indigenous, autonomous way in the Muslim world.
He never told me that it would be easy. He said suffering would come, but he promised peace.
The most mind-blowing aspects of the church in Iran in particular is that central to their theology, their redemptive theology, and their understanding not only of who Jesus is, what he came to do, but what he will return to do, is a covenantal theology that has Israel at the center. I mean, think about that.
I love the way the Lord loves to just flip the script. You know, in the natural, when you ask most people, you say, what is the greatest existential threat to Israel? And everyone's going to say Iran, and that's true. In terms of the potential ability to literally wipe Israel out, it's Iran. But behind the scenes, in terms of behind the curtains, what is God doing? The fact of the matter is, right now, God is raising up in Iran one of the greatest, fastest growing movements of former Muslims that are falling in love with not only the God of Israel, not only Israel's king, not only Israel's Messiah, but they're actually falling in love with the Jewish people. And as a result of this, you have a prayer movement in Iran that is crying out for and praying for the salvation of Israel. I mean, this is something only God can do that.
Iran and Israel, or the Persians and the Jews, have a very long history.
He never told me that it wouldn't be easy. He said suffering would come, but he promised peace.
think about the political realities and the news, you view Israel and Iran as being arch enemies. But you have this church that's growing in the underground in Iran explosively, and at the core, the center of their theology is Jesus on the throne. Not just Jesus on a heavenly throne, but Jesus literally returning to this city, to return to Jerusalem to sit on a throne, and holding that at the core of their theology. Think about how provocative that is.
If the fastest growing church in the world today is growing in the heart of the Muslim world in Iran, beloved, I believe that we're on the cusp of something very profound and very dramatic in the Middle East, but globally as well. And this is going to have implications here in Israel. We need to understand that dark, dark days are coming for the Jewish people, for the state of Israel, for the land of Israel. And that there is a mounting conflict and a mounting crisis that's going to culminate in the humbling and the crushing and the breaking of the strength of this beloved people that the Lord loves so much. In order for the church to be mature in the generation of the Lord's return, we need to be full of mature, fervent, tested love for the Jewish people that can endure the fires and the tribulation that's mounting on the horizon.
I love getting Western believers together with the underground believers because, you know, in the West we have wonderful theology of victory, we have theology of prosperity and all of these things. We have good theology of healing, and I love all of those things. However, oftentimes we are really weak when it comes to a proper biblical theology of suffering. And we're definitely weak when it comes to a proper biblical theology of martyrdom.
And this is why I think that we in the West who are bought into standing with Israel, or those who are antagonistic to it, need to hear the witness of the church in Iran. Because they're not saying that we should stand with them just on some political level. In terms of spectrum, I think that's the weakest and most shallow expression of solidarity, acknowledging the legitimacy of Jewish presence and Jewish state in the Middle East. It's actually standing with them in future suffering when persecution breaks out during the future time of Jacob's trouble, and we enter into that season with them shoulder to shoulder. And the church in the Middle East desperately needs this.
You look at the early church, they believed in martyrdom. They believed that martyrdom was actually the greatest success. If you were martyred for the faith, this was the greatest example of bearing witness to who Jesus is. Why? Because it communicates something very powerfully. It says that I believe in the resurrection of the dead. And because of what Jesus did for me, I will be raised up. That's the gospel. That is the summation of the gospel. And it's demonstrated. You can't demonstrate it any more powerfully than laying down the one life that we have, laying it down and saying, He's going to raise me up on that day.
We're here in Luxembourg meeting with our FAI family as well as the Maranatha family. We've been meeting in several different cities here in Europe with some representatives from and leadership from the Church of Iran. One of the reasons we've come together is because we really want to look at what's happening in Iran, and we want to learn from it. We're not just wanting to learn from their success in their ministry so that we can grow in success in our own ministry, but we're wanting to learn from the vibrant relationship with the Lord that the individuals have.
The most impactful thing that he shared with me was a story about his wife, actually, something that his wife said that has really stuck in my head. He talked about how years ago they had an opportunity to move to the United States and live there, so they did. And then after being in the United States for a short period of time, his wife began to plead with him to take her back to Iran, which he felt like was crazy. I mean, who wants to move back to Iran under all sorts of oppression, where the sharing of your faith could bring the end of your life, or brutal incarceration, or rape, or all sorts of horrible things? Who wants to do that? I mean, who wants to move from the United States to Iran? She told him, there's a satanic lullaby here, and all the Christians are sleepy, and I'm feeling sleepy. And that little story disturbed me, because this woman was discerning a threat to her faith that was a greater threat than the kind of persecution that happens in Iran. And that threat was spiritual sleepiness. That is a more dangerous situation than persecution. And I had to ask myself the question, is that true? Is that true?
It's impossible to come to Europe and not be confronted with this reality of dead religion. As we've been bouncing around from city to city across this incredible continent and pondering and wrestling with what the Lord is doing in Iran, I can't help but feel that the Lord wants to confront the dead religion in our lives, and He wants to do it through the church in Iran. Now, historically, when the Lord confronts the spirit of religion, what He does is He takes insignificant women and He puts them in the middle of the room, and He allows them to express themselves in their affection and their love and their allegiance to Him. And He allows the confrontation, the collision of that thing to take place. And I really believe that the church in Iran is like a corporate Mary of Bethany that is confronting all of the opposition in our own hearts to giving everything that we have for the Lord.
Actually, persecution keeps you clean, in the sense that when you're under a persecuted state, you're constantly leaning into God. You're constantly running to Him as your refuge.
When I look at the witness of Scripture and I look at the witness of Christian history, what I see is that whenever ease and affluence and power is given to the church, it seems to disease. And it does all kinds of damage. Not only does it introduce the kind of motivational corruption that just diseases the church, but it just seems to produce lethargy and indifference.
It's through this pressure, hardship, and suffering that people are coming to Jesus. I'd rather them suffer and be under pressure and be under an authoritative dictatorship, and millions come to Jesus, and maybe even the whole country can come to Jesus, then freedom, openness, and democracy, and half those people come to Jesus.
What's in front of persecuted Christians frequently is what the gospel is all about. And what's in front of affluent Christians in a free society is not only that, but a whole range of options for life and for time and for use of money. And that is a dangerous thing.
In Revelation, the only church that was not critiqued by Jesus was the first church. And the first church is the only church that was truly under suffering and persecution the whole time. I'd rather see millions of people come to Jesus than have freedom. I'd rather see millions of people come to Jesus than democracy. We're playing for eternity here. This is not something temporal, like, okay, they're free to not wear a headscarf, they're free to choose their elected officials. If freedom was such a great thing for the kingdom, then why is America and Europe in the state it is now?
What's happening in Iran right now is they're experiencing God as being all-sufficient in his ability to deliver people, not necessarily out of their circumstances, but in their soul, find deliverance and life that goes far beyond having a nice life here on this earth, but a hope for something that lasts for eternity. And to me, that's the difference. The church in the West is living for how can we make this life the best possible life? And the church in Iran is saying, forget this life, I'm living for the next one.
We can learn so much from the people in persecution, like our Iranian brothers and sisters, how they are doing. They have to do it. They have to do it, and it works. It is decentralized. It is a movement of brothers and sisters without big leadership. They are led by the Holy Spirit, and they trust each other. Living relationship, living unity, and it works. People are coming, hundreds, thousands are coming to follow the Lord. And if it works in places of persecution, why don't we learn from them? Why don't we start doing it here before the persecution for us is coming? Why don't we start now being trained and do it the same way? So the harvest is big, and if we see that it works there, why shouldn't it work here? Let's start doing the same thing, not what the Iranians do. Let's do what Jesus did. He called them to the table. The Iranians do what Jesus did. Let's do what Jesus did and learn from the Iranian people how to do it.
For her, lethargy and indifference was a greater threat than persecution. And it is. It simply is.
Like a thief in the night, with a dog in the fight, it took the world by surprise. You woke the woods from a sleep, blew the wind through the trees, shook the dust from the leaves. Everything, this is gonna change everything. This is gonna change everything. This is gonna change everything.
Confessing with our mouths that Jesus is Lord, we should not only begin to be like him, but it should change everything about our lives. And when you're with these women, you can see they've been with him.
They're just fiery and fruitful. And I couldn't honestly say that right now, in the environments I've been in, that would be true. I'm believing, we're praying, we're hoping that that will be true.
I believe the Lord wants to deal a decisive blow to dead religion in us and around us. I believe that the church in Iran is the instrument that he wants to use in our generation to catalyze this globally.
The one who stays in my love, who takes his life and gives it up, he is the one who has enough. Oh, he has it.
I really do believe that meeting Jesus should change everything in our lives. And if it's not, then I don't know if we know him.
Everything, this is gonna change everything. This is gonna change everything. This is gonna change everything. This is gonna change everything.
I think if we were to try to characterize the days that we're living in days of radical decentralization and the distribution of everything that possibly can be distributed. You know, back in the day, information was controlled. You know, leadership, government, military, economy, everything was very controlled and centralized. And today, everything's being decentralized. The center of everything is disappearing and going away, and everything's being distributed.
It's empowered the average person to have access to information in a way that has never been available in human history. And so in a lot of ways, dictators, they can try, but they really can't hold on to power the way they used to be able to. Dictators may be able to hold on to power with an iron fist, but they don't have the hearts of the people anymore. They can't control the hearts of the people. We look at dictators and we say, yeah, amen, but the fact is, it's the same thing in the church.
The church structures in the West for a very long time have been very centralized and very non-distributed.
There have been, historically, if we're honest, there have been dictators in the body of Christ, and their time is gone, their hour is over. And the gospel, it belongs to everyone.
It's a pyramid structure of a few people leading the many. And what we see in an age of distribution is that we see the many distributing leadership among themselves very broadly. And I believe that that's at the heart of Maranatha. Maranatha is a decentralized fellowship of disciple makers and churches globally that are operating within this context of decentralization and distribution of leadership.
I believe in this final hour, we're stepping into a period when we will all share resources because we have a common goal. It's no longer about this ministry has this kingdom and this preacher has his particular platform. If we don't lay down our ministries, lay down our platforms for the common cause of the completion of the Great Commission, then in my opinion, we're going to be swept to the side really just within a few years.
Maranatha is an Aramaic word that's actually a play on words, and depending on how you pronounce it, it means either the Lord has come in the past, or Lord come, or the Lord is coming in the future. And this message of Maranatha, I believe, what Paul was using it as is a way to centralize the message and the thought life and the feelings, the emotions, the hope of the early church around a centralized message while decentralizing and distributing leadership of the heralding and proclaiming of that message throughout the known world.
Maranatha means to me, we all know this story of Zacchaeus sitting on this tree, this small guy, no one taking care for. But Jesus came and he saw him and said, come down, I have a little booklet for you, read it. At the end of the booklet there's a prayer, if you pray it, you will go to heaven. And I invite you for next Shabbat to come into the synagogue. I have a nice message, it will change your life. No, he didn't. He said, come down, I have to eat with you. I have to have dinner with you. I have to eat at your table. I want to sit at your table. He visited him in his house and they had community, and Zacchaeus was changed.
I saw a message from a group of Iranian believers where essentially they were bringing blessing and greetings for a group of us who'd gathered to align ourselves around the purposes of God and to celebrate this incredible watchword, this cry, this prayer, this reality that we call Maranatha. I see this group of Iranian believers who are using the same word. They're saying to us, Maranatha, come Lord. What hit me in the moment was that these guys really believed it. If it's possible to sense something more than just what you can hear in your ears, with your spiritual ears, what I was hearing was this Maranatha cry where they were literally asking the Lord to come now.
Being in the early church that was predominantly Jewish, you would greet each other and say, Shalom, Shalom. But as the church became more and more Gentile, Shalom didn't work as an appropriate greeting anymore. Because how would a Gentile and a Jew greet each other? And so Maranatha became adopted as the way of expressing your unity and the identification as believers in this global fellowship. I believe this is at the heart of what the Maranatha family is today. It's connecting believers all around the world together in a spirit of fellowship, in a spirit of loyalty and affection and love, that we would be knit and joined together for the growing up and the maturity of the church before the return of the Lord.
And there is a movement coming of these little ones no one takes care for. And the Lord is telling them, come to the table. I want to sit at your table. And they are inviting others on their table. And they will be changed. They will be moved. The big religion organizations, one day they will realize that there's a movement. They know nothing about it. They know nothing about it because it's decentralized. It is a movement of the little ones. I am a little one and I want to go with these little ones.
It's just not really Zaki or Hastan, the Tai Safan, but this is not Massi Molokotona. But the whole show is that Massi Hodesh Sangi would have a radish rather. و تمام ردشدهای کل دنیا براشون جا هستی دیگه من بارها شده خودم گفتم محال این بتونه کاری انجام بده ولی خدا فکر اشتباه منو تصحیح کرد و خدا نشون داده همونی که حسابش نکردم همون کسیه که کلیساها شروع کرد این قدرت روح القدس و مسیحه و اینه ماراناتا پریز
When Paul said Maranatha, what he's saying is this. The basis of our unity as believers doesn't have to be a 1,000-point theological doctrinal statement. Do you guys in Corinth believe that he came once for sin? They would say yes. He would say, do you believe he's coming again for judgment and to restore all things? They would say yes. And he would say, then we're brothers. Maranatha. And they would say Maranatha back.
So part of their Maranatha cry is, even if you wait, even if you tarry, I'll lay my life down. I'll give whatever it takes because I know you're going to pick it back up. If we would embrace this eternal perspective, what might we do?
Look, I think the modern church, we've got the hallelujah down, but I think we've forgotten the Maranatha cry of the early church. We've lost that cry. Come, Lord Jesus, how much longer? And so to me, Maranatha is a recovery of the Maranatha cry that drove them, this urgency that drove that early church to turn the ancient world upside down in just a generation. And I think we're about to do it again.
Fire in his eyes and hair like wool, and a voice like a torrent of water so full. Out of his mouth comes a double-edged sword. He's coming in glory, he's coming to make war. Fire in his eyes and hair like wool, and a voice like a torrent of water so full. Out of his mouth comes a double-edged sword. He's coming in glory, he's coming to make war. Maranatha, come Lord Jesus. Maranatha, come Lord Jesus. Maranatha, come Lord Jesus. Return to us. Maranatha, come Lord Jesus. Maranatha, come Lord Jesus. Maranatha, come Lord Jesus. Return to us.
Look at the totality of Scripture, Genesis to Revelation, and this whole story, this massive story of God's love for us and his desire to redeem all that fell apart in the first couple of chapters. I think you can almost hear the cry from the Garden of Maranatha. Even from the second chapter, the third chapter of the book of Genesis, is there a better word? Is there a deeper cry from the heart, the human heart, than come, Lord?
From Bethlehem to Jerusalem, from Galilee, over to Bethany, he's been faithful, he'll always be so faithful, so we sing. From Bethlehem to Jerusalem, from Galilee, over to Bethany, he's been faithful, he'll always be so faithful, so we sing. Maranatha, come Lord Jesus. Maranatha, come Lord Jesus. Maranatha, come Lord Jesus, return to us.
Maranatha in the Church of Iran is believing what has happened, that Jesus died on the cross and was resurrected, and looking forward to Jesus coming back. That is our compass. This is the place we look at the world. This is our frame of mind in the sense that when we walk outside, we really don't care if we get arrested. We're not upset if we get arrested. What's 50 years in prison compared to eternity with Jesus?
I believe heaven will open up and the Son of Man will come for us. At the end of the age, we will behold the King coming on the clouds in all his glory.
Just 2 days ago, the head of the IRGC's airspace division boasted that Iran is capable of building missiles with a range beyond 2,000 kilometers. He said, quote, "We have the ability to build missiles with broader ranges. We don't have limitations from a technical perspective," end of quote. He also said there are many enemy bases within 800 kilometers of Iran. In other words, within striking distance of Iranian missiles. He bragged that Iran does 40 to 50 tests per year. As I'll talk about further, it is clear that the Iranian regime's ballistic missile activity has grown since the nuclear deal. Iran has exploited the goodwill of nations and defied multiple Security Council resolutions in its quest for a robust ballistic missile force. The United States will never stand for this. No nation that seeks peace and prosperity in the Middle East should either.
رژیم صهیونیستی وقتی که میبینه اون راه برد محو این رژیم از جغرافیای سیاسی عالم شکل گرفته و ظرفیت‌های متناسب با اعمال این راه برد هم شکل گرفته، به اونها این هشدار را میدین که شما دارید خودتون رو به مرگ نزدیک میکنید. باید مطمئن باشند که این جنگ محو اونها را به دنبال خواهد داشت. نابود شدن دنبال قبرستان‌های در خارج از فلسطین اشغالی باشند. یعنی میخوام همه کسانی که امروز صحبت‌های من رو میشنوند، همه قدرت‌ها به این واقعیت جدید در موضوع قدرت موشکی جمهوری اسلامی ایران برسند که ما برای افزایش برد و دقت‌های بالا در بردهای بلند و قدرت تخریب دلخواه
Because the church in Iran, I believe, from the Lord's perspective, is not just about raising up the fastest growing church in the world. I believe it's about raising up a resistance church in the heart of the Middle East that will lead by example for the rest of the nations around the Middle East when the final scourge and the final invasion and the final wave of persecution hits the Jewish people. In Zechariah 14, it says that before he steps on this hill, the Mount of Olives, that half of this city will go into captivity. That the houses will be pillaged, the women will be raped, possessions will be stolen. We see that they're dividing up Jewish land in Joel chapter 3. Matthew 24 says that when you see the invasion begin, get out of the city. Don't turn back. Don't go get stuff. Don't turn around. Flee. Flee to the mountains. Get out of the city. These are a couple of literally hundreds of passages that talk about a future calamity that will befall the Jewish people on the soil upon which this age-old controversy began. And when that happens, the nations around Israel are going to be called into account. Will they stand with the invaders and the persecutors, or will they stand against it and stand with the Jewish people?
Most people naturally think of Iran and Israel as mortal enemies, and there's no question that the Iranian regime is a tremendous threat to Israel. But historically, when you look at biblical history, there were episodes where the Persian peoples were a tremendous blessing to Israel. And I'm convinced that those events in history, when Cyrus actually sends Israel out and gives them permission and commissions them to actually rebuild the temple and this sort of thing, I believe all of that was a powerful prophetic foreshadow of the blessing that the Iranian people will be to to God's covenant people in the last days.
I believe what the Lord is doing through the church in Iran is raising up a resistance church that's not only going to stand against the plans of the evil one for the extermination of the Jewish people, not only are they going to stand against it, they're going to be used as an agent to provoke the Jewish people to salvation during those days. And in those days, what we're going to see is the same dynamic that we see in the book of Esther. That what Satan meant for evil, God is using for good.
Don't you find it interesting how much hatred comes from Iran, but maybe not that much of Saudi Arabia, maybe not that much from Kuwait, even Egypt, very powerful Sunni countries, but all the hatred, all the rhetoric comes from Iran. Why? Because we have a spiritual destiny of brotherhood, of family.
ما برای دنیا خلق نشده ایم. ما انتخاب شده ایم تا جهاد کنیم. ما جهانی با آنها مبارزه می کنیم. نه در یک نقطه. جنگ ما محلی نیست. ما برای شکست دادن قدرت‌های جهانی برنامه داریم. ما برای شکستن آمریکا و اسرائیل و شرکا و متحدان آنها برنامه ریزی میکنیم. نیروی زمینی ما باید زمین را از لوس وجود اینها پاک کنند.
و چون اخبار غلط بهشون میگن که اینا ستمگرن، خونریزن، اینا بدشون میاد از یهودی ها، کاملا دیدا عوض میشه و مردم عاشق یهودی ها میشن، چون یه واقعیت مطلع میشن، یه چیز که دروغ بوده و واقعیتش میبینن، ولی وقتی حقیقت رو میفهمن و میفهمن حتی خدا از طرف یهود رو زمین اومد، عاشق یهودی ها میشن.
You think about the role of the nations to provoke the Jew to jealousy, and I think of that oftentimes as like an American who is an evangelical believer who comes to Israel to tour the land and to be able to say to the Jewish people, I love you and I love your land. And I love it because, you know, this is the place that my Lord lived and died and rose again and he'll return to. And I don't know that it always strikes them as being provoking. When I think of an Iranian interacting with a Jewish person and saying, I love you, and I love your land because I believe it's the place that my Lord will come, Jesus will come and rule and reign. And for that reason, I will lay my life down for you. I don't think provoking is the right word. Provoking almost minimizes what that might look like to a Jewish heart. When you talk about provoking the Jew to jealousy, I don't know that it gets any better than that.
And I believe with all my heart that the spirit of Islam, which is Haman, very soon is going to hang by its own neck, and Iran is going to open the floodgates of the gospel into Israel. I believe with all my heart that Iran is like Esther, that she's going to go to the king and ask for the freedom of the Jews. And what Iran is literally going to do is they're going to bring the gospel to free the Jews. Imagine when their mortal enemies are transformed to their best friends through the blood of Christ.
On the outside looking in, it sometimes appears as though Satan has affected very strategic victories. I mean, because of the astounding success of Islam all over the earth, even though it looks that way, even though it looks as though the enemy is prevailing and that his plots and his schemes are actually going to win, going to prevail over the purposes of God, that is absolutely not the end of the story. What we're seeing right now is the early stages of a profound plot twist.
the gallows that Haman built to execute his plan of genocide was used as the instrument by which he himself was hung. The noose that's about to be put around the devil's neck is this. It's the fullness of the Gentiles coming in, the salvation and the deliverance of the Jewish people, and the return of Messiah to Jerusalem to establish his forever rule and his forever reign, when he will wipe away all tears and vindicate every promise that was ever made. The culmination of this great drama of the ages is the devil hanging on his own gallows.
Someone's on the prowl, trying to take us down, but we ain't giving up now. A liar and a thief coming after you and me, but we ain't giving up now. The harder the river go, the deeper our roots will go, and the devil is gonna hang. Oh, the devil is gonna hang. Oh, the devil is gonna hang from his own
Oh.